Krásný prosincový večer, milí diváci, na poslední přednášce kruhu v prosinci 2020, kdy jsme se přesunuli do online prostoru. Kruh vstupuje do 21. cyklu přednášek a můžete se těšit na zajímavý program, který začne od března roku 2021. Děkujeme, že s námi celý cyklus sledujete, a to i v tomto živém streamu, kdy se nám za malou chviličku představí dánský progresivní ateliér Johansen Skovstedt Architekter. Přednáškou s názvem Po ruce zakončujeme letošní projekt s názvem Severská cesta, věnovaný skandinávské architektuře. Děkujeme také za to, že vám můžeme umožnit nákup virtuálních vstupenek přes síť GoOut na dnešní akci a vaší podpory se moc vážíme. Dánská kancelář Johansen Skovstedt Architekter sídlí v Kodani a byla založena dvěma architekty, Sørenem Johansenem a Sebastianem Skovstedtem. Studio reprezentuje kodaňskou progresivní architekturu a během několika let dosáhlo velkého uznání. Architekti získali národní i mezinárodní ocenění. Jejich stavby a budovy jsou na první pohled jednoduché objemy. Inspirují se základními formami, lidovou architekturou, anonymním průmyslovým dědictvím i bezprostředním okolím. Ke kontextu i stávajícím budovám přistupují citlivě a doplňují neokázalými současnými prostředky. Ateliér vám dnes představí oba zmínění architekti zakladatelé. Ukáží nám přístup studia na různých projektech, představí například své jednoduché sochařské formy nebo renovace v rezervaci Tipern a budou se také věnovat svému zdařilému projektu rekonstrukci technické památky v ústí řeky Skjern. Za realizaci této přednášky děkujeme všem z kruhu, prostoru Kina Světozor, ale i všem našim partnerům a institucím, které vidíte na svých počítačích. Někteří jsou s námi již celých 20 let a všem patří náš dík. Aktuality o činnosti spolku kruhu můžete sledovat na našem webu nebo sociálních sítích. Můžete nás podpořit také koupí naší nové publikace rozhovorů a přednášek architektů a architektek, kteří do Prahy zavítali v rámci cyklu Jiná perspektiva architektky. V knize najdete například architektku Anet Žigon, Dorte Mandrup, architekta Hanse Kolhofa, Jonatana Sergisna nebo Christofra Gantenbeina. Knihu si můžete objednat také prostřednictvím online knihkupců. Na příští rok máme připravený velmi zajímavý nový cyklus Dialogy. Do Prahy by měly zavítat významné osobnosti, kteří již v kruhu vystoupili a k sobě si dle uvážení vyberou druhého inspirativního architekta, teoretika nebo umělce. Začínáme tak jako každý rok, první čtvrtek v březnu. Nyní si pustíme krátká videa našeho generálního partnera a našich hlavních partnerů. Tak a nyní je mi ctí vám představit dánský progresivní ateliér Johansen Skovstedt Architektr. Představí se nám oba zakladatelé, Sebastian a Sørenov, a které v České republice virtuálně vítám. Hello Sebastian and hello Søren. How are you in Copenhagen?
Very good, thank you. And
happy you agreed with this presentation. How is the situation?
The situation in Denmark, it's a little bit getting a little bit worse with Corona in the city of Copenhagen and the surroundings of Copenhagen. But it's still we cannot complain comparing to many other countries. We had been looking forward to travel to Prague, but we are very happy that we could do this instead online. So thank you to Kruch for the invitation. So I'm Sebastian Skovstedt, and this is Søren Johansen, and together we founded our office, Johansen Skovstedt Architects, back in 2014. Already 2 years before that, in 2012, we started working together on the first assignments. So in the beginning, we worked both of us in other offices and started working evenings and weekends, and then later on we had more projects and it became a full-time practice. So at the moment we are, I will share the screen now. So can everyone see the screen now? Yes. So at the moment we are, so we're actually sitting in our office right now, and this is from a different room. So we're placed in Copenhagen in the meatpacking district in a listed building. It's a former sausage factory, and we are around 7 people in the office. We are working with different scales, from building furniture to larger projects. Right now we're working on an office building and warehouse of 3,000 square meters. So our projects are quite different in scale, but something that goes, that is a continuing thing from project to project, is that we try to, when we start up a project, we take a starting point in the context and the program, which I think is quite usual as architects. But we also try to combine this like very first idea with a specific building technique or craft, or a way of building. So we try to develop each project very closely together with a way of building. And in this sense, we can have dialogue with experts within this field and specialized engineers, etc., contractors and manufacturers, and we can develop the project hand in hand with these specific ways you can build and not build within this technique. So in the end, we have a result that is more like optimized, and where our ideas are not a compromise in the end with what is actually possible to build, but it's more the other way around, that things are benefiting from each other. And tonight we will show a range of build projects, and the last project we will show is still under construction, and we will try to show how we deal in each project with this way of working.
So the first project that we brought is Tibone. Tibone is one of two projects on the western coast of Denmark. The other project will be later in the presentation. So Tibone is this peninsula in a laguna called Ringkøbing Fjord, which is this area. Next to the laguna, there's a river where we have the other project, Skjernå. So Tibone is a bird sanctuary, and it's a flat, open wetland, which is almost in the same level as the sea next to the landscape. And it is quite close to the ocean, and it's a protected habitat, and it has been subject to continuous bird counts for a very long continuous duration. And the project was commissioned because the nature agency that owns the area wanted to open up the area for visitors. It has been closed off for visitors mostly. And in opening up the area, they wanted new facilities for visitors while still maintaining facilities for the professional bird counters. So here's a few images of the area. And it is recognizable from having a very dramatic atmosphere because it's so close to the sea, but it has a very, the landscape is very subdued or simple. So it sort of exposes the drama of the sky. And when we started the project, these elements were there on the site. There was a house, an annex, and a tower from the Second World War. The tower was used by the professional bird counters, but was in decay, so it had to be replaced. So this is a new site plan, where the Tipper House has been converted. The houses behind the Tipper House and the tower has been removed and partly replaced by a new workshop, and there's been built a new tower. If we zoom out, this you see here is the area that is accessible for visitors, and we also added a bird hide, which is this red dot you see out here, and constructed a small pond down here. So this is a view of the Tipper House from the tower, and behind it the workshop, and a floor plan of the Tipper House. And basically, we converted the Tipper House so that the ground floor plan would be open for visitors with an exhibition and dining space on one side and a multipurpose space that could be used by larger groups on the other side. And in the middle, we made a kitchen, which is servicing the bird counters that we converted the first floor for. So just going through the ground floor plan, we replaced the load-bearing walls to open up the plan with the timber constructions, beams and columns, and reinforcements on the wall, also in timber. And we painted the installations in a red to sort of emphasize some of these elements that the bird counters are using, like wind measuring devices that you see on the wall. And we did the custom furniture. And on the first floor, we fitted a library or workspace for the professional bird counters in the middle. And we made two rooms with the alcoves for the bird counters to if they stay overnight, they can stay. And we did the built-in furniture in OSB, which we treated with a diluted paint to get some of this texture that reminds us of the vegetations of the area. And we fitted the main room, the library space, with the bookshelves for this continuous bird count that has been going on, actually the longest continuous bird count of any place in Europe. And they have all of their archives they have in ring binders, 40 meters of them. So we had to fit that into the space. So this is why there's so many shelves. So in the next part of the project is a workshop. And the workshop takes its inspiration from a nearby settlement of hunting lodges, which is also on Tibone. And these are these very small houses, very intimistic and without water, building water, or also without power. And this is the workshop. And the workshop is basically a timber frame structure that is stiffened by 3 millimeter aluminium plates that are mounted on the inside of the structure to give the rhythm of the facade. And the openings are made for light with the glass fiber panels. So here you can see basically it's the small structure. It's a toilet for visitors. It's a workshop, and it's oil tanks and other technical stuff for the house. This is an interior. So on the interior, we left the aluminium untreated to have this easy to maintain surfaces. And the next part of the project is the bird hide. This part of the project is placed free of the rest of the settlement in order to give the whole the amount of built objects more a feeling of being scattered in the landscape, and not so much the feeling of being a deliberate settlement in one part of the landscape. So basically, something that is characteristic for the whole of Tibane is that there's a lot of ochre in the ground that also makes the water in the ponds red, and also the vegetation has this red color. What you see here is the bird hide, this triangular shape here. And the idea for the bird hide is to create a space that you can go into and arrive to unseen, so as not to disturb the wildlife. And in this way, you can come close to the wildlife. The structure is made of quartz and steel plates that are joined with the steel, quartz and steel profiles that create the connection to the ground. So it's slightly lifted above the ground, as you see here. The structure is sort of, so if you look at the bushes in the landscape, they are all tilting away from the coast because there's so strong winds. So the idea of having this sort of tent-like shape that has been sort of displaced is also referring to the vegetation. And here you can see that the structure is basically, it's just these plates with the joining profiles. One profile here creates a gutter that protects a seating place here. And the last of the structures of this project is the tower. And this is not it, but it's something that is throughout the landscape are these small places that the bird counters go to count the birds. And this small plywood box is sort of, in a way, also a reference for the project. So here you can see the tower. So the thing with making a tower is that because we have this very open landscape, we have at one time something that sort of seems large or endless, but at the same time is very fragile. So whatever you put into it can be visible, viewed from any place in the landscape. And we didn't want to have the figure of the tower to be like an element that broke this horizontality. So we wanted the horizon to pass through the structure. And also we wanted the structure to have sort of an airiness that could have an interplay with this very dense atmosphere. And we looked at different kind of structures, and we realized that a certain kind of production method where you make steel pylons from massive round iron bars was the one that could create this kind of play with the light, because the light breaks in a very soft way in a round shape, as compared to steel pylons made from angular steel, you get this very sharp shadow. So we found a factory quite close to the site that were manufacturing steel pylons in a massive round steel. And we went to the factory and we started to learn about their production facility. And we developed the design based on the production facility, on the way that they, the machinery they have, the way they do their weldings and so on. So that was an early sketch. Through the process, we found out that the bird watchers, they needed to have the exact same conditions in the new tower as in the old tower, because they have the scientific way of working is, of course, that you don't want to disturb the basis of your observations. So they needed to have the same conditions for the observations going forward. And they wanted to have used their old telescope, which is this 2.2-meter telescope. They wanted to have an enclosed space to do it in, and they wanted to have the exact same viewing angles available. So we started to do the design based on the top, based on the fact that the floor of the top had to be in the same height as the existing tower. The viewing angles had to be the same. The sweeping motion of the telescope had to be the same. And so basically that defined the top of the tower, and this is the study that we based on. So I'm just going to go through the structure from the top and down. So this is an axonometry of the top of the tower. With each side has four sliding doors. You see here. And you can see how here the doors, they open and close. And actually, there's no corner column, so it's possible to open up completely in a corner to get a larger viewing angle. And the whole tower is held together by the roof, which is three bent elements from steel plates, where we use the bent of the steel plate to create a structural quality, so like a beam in the roof, and also to join the plates. And in the sides, we join with the construction of the tower. And in that way, the roof holds together the tower. So this is view from the inside of the tower, and you can see here the structure without the corner column, the large glass panels that can be rotated in to protect from the wind. And here a detail of the hatch, which is also a very heavy element, because it's also produced from a massive 10 millimeter steel plate. And in order to make it possible to open, we fitted it with a counterweight, which is this triangular shape you can see here, which is attached to the to the hatch. Maybe this is more understandable. So when it's unlocked, it opens up to an upright position by itself, and this triangular shape appears in the tower. So here you see a view from the joining of two sections of the tower. So basically, a section of the tower is never joined with each other, but it's sort of joined in the overlay with the section above and below. So you can see this kind of join. And the tower is stepping out, so each section becomes larger in footprint to accommodate the minimum size of the viewing platform, and to get the smallest tower at the same time. And due to the footprint becoming larger and larger for each section, also the height had to be larger in order to maintain the same inclination on the stair. So here is the vertical joining of the sections, where you can see how each section, the landing between the stairs, acts as a connecting element between the inner and the outer part of the structure. And here, this is a section in the joining between two sections, and you can see how they protrude, and there's a piece of steel in between with a shadow. So actually it's a relatively thick construction element, but it seems more light due to this separation. And because we have the shifting of the sections, the columns, they also move in the position. So it has been possible for us to join the sections with bolts that has been there have been cut holes into the columns with a threading, so the bolts could be mounted directly into the columns from above and below. And this is the joining of one section with the stairs that are also from these 10 millimeter plates. That means that they also transfer forces in the same way as that diagonal between the inner and the outer structure. Some elements from the factory. And here you see that basically the pressure is transferred through the columns in the corner and these figure columns, which are 65 millimeters in diameter and 50 millimeters. And all of these smaller dots, they are these thinner columns, they are protecting so you don't fall out from the staircases, but they're also transferring tensile forces from the structure to the foundation. And here's a few images from the factory of the sections being made of the template. So basically, the whole structure had to be assembled on factory and then transported to site and mounted and collected there. And in order to be sure that the foundation and the tower fitted with each other, we made a template that was transported to the site, and all of the elements that had to be cast into the foundation was cast with the template. And the template then returned and the tower built on top of the template. So basically what you see here is the lowest section. These join the foundation, and below we have a beam that transfer the forces of the 22 millimeter columns to the foundation. And here the terrain lands just below this line. So basically the foundation is not visible. And then the structure lands directly in the landscape. And actually all of the elements of the tower have a structural quality or as a part of the structural system. And this was something that we wanted to do in order to get this very slender character of the tower. But it was also something that we realized had another effect, that you could sort of feel that you can feel that there's forces moving through the structure. It has sort of a vibrating feeling to it. And it's also making a sound. So when the wind is blowing, you can hear a sound from the tower. And this is something that we find quite fascinating. So in an exhibition that we finished some months ago now, we had a sound artist that recorded the sounds of the tower with the contact microphones and replayed them in the gallery with the vibrational speakers, which are those that you see on the sides and also in the window, still transferring the vibrations of the tower into the exhibition space. The next project that we'll show tonight is it's also in a landscape. It's a quite different landscape. It's more a hilly landscape, and it's the project is actually a reinterpretation of a historic cottage and shed. It's built in Denmark for a private client, and in collaboration with Lask Studio. It was finished just a few years ago. So the summer house is situated in this protected landscape. So everything, the nature, but also the buildings in this specific landscape was one of the first areas in Denmark with planned summer houses, placed very specific in the landscape and freestanding with just the open nature around it. So the existing cottage was in a very bad condition, actually in a condition where we could not keep it. So we had to
to make a new house with the exterior like the old cottage, but with all the requirements from building permissions, regulations, insulation, etc., from a new summer house. So it was quite unusual task to do, and we started doing very carefully service of what was left from the original cottage to rebuild it, but in a new way. So what you see here is the original house before it fell into decay, and this is a historic photo from around the beginning of the 80s, and just to say a few things about the story of the house. So in 1905 it was built like two separate log houses, and then a few years later it was these two log houses were connected with a third wing and cladded with these wooden boards, and so it was a bit like this kind of the existing house was a little bit kind of a collapse, like a collapse also interior wise, as you will see in a few seconds. So we had to here you can see from the construction of the new house we had to put insulation and everything, and to really, this is again from the before the house fell into decay, and this is a new situation. So you can see that we made it the same place in the landscape, the same volume and the same way, more or less, but with a few exceptions. So for instance, the existing house didn't have any bathroom or shower or even electricity and these kind of facilities. So we added this shower niche as a kind of reference to this roof chapel on the existing shed. And we didn't make these specific corners with the wrapped locks, but we emphasized these wooden profiles. Another thing that was quite special about the existing house was these kind of different wood carvings that we could replace by copying what was left from the original ones and using the owner's sawmill. So it was important for the client to try to kind of this specific atmosphere that was in the old house. She actually, as a child, she spent her summers in this house, and she had these memories of this wooden house, and she wanted to somehow that we could recall this atmosphere, but in a new interpretation. So what you see here is a new plan that's more or less the same organization as the existing house. But if you look carefully, you can see that the structural system, instead of using these locks, it's actually just a very simple timber frame construction. It's, you could say, it's like the most common way of building a house, at least a summer house in Denmark. So we tried to find inspiration in this way of building and see how we could recall these situations from the existing house. So this is a section. So for instance, this is from the old house interior, the living room, where you can see this this low connection between kitchen and living room, and you obviously see these horizontal wooden locks. So in the new house, it's on one hand, it's a very different atmosphere. It's much brighter, more windows. It's a different interior, but it also has very clear references. So, for instance, these are very wide horizontal wooden planks on the inside of the exterior walls, and they are referring to the locks, but they're also just referring to be a cladding of this new structural system. Another characteristic thing was this situation with the stair and the small mezzanine, and this combination of painted and unpainted surfaces. So, as I said, the original house was built and changed several times. So we wanted to somehow recall this feeling by trying to find a logic within the new system. So we have a variation of painted and unpainted surfaces, and these horizontal planks and the vertical planks and the interior walls, and different tiles, etc. Another characteristic thing was to have this these wooden roof planks, and of course you would have this in a house that's not insulated, but we wanted to work with these exposed beams, but without having them as a kind of extra beam, because you normally have the beams nowadays in between insulation. So we found this pressure resistant insulation that actually allowed us to have these structural visual roof beams. In the original house, there were these alcove beds that we somehow tried to very simple recall by working with painted and unpainted surfaces, and like these different built-in situations with furniture. And another aspect was this old house was built with as houses were at that time, like a series of more kind of defined spaces. So when we have a situation like this where we wanted to make a more open, I could say more modern connection between spaces, we tried to kind of compensate or to work with very clear difference in this situation and color between the kitchen and the corridor. So maybe to summarize, we wanted to find these new situations of dealing with regulations and requirements from the client, and as a new house, but trying to find these memories and this atmosphere by making things referring to the new way of building, but at the same time to the old house. And just to show the shed that was more a one-to-one way of rebuilding, because it was not with new insulation, so it was easier just to build it from these drawings that we made of the old shed. But there was this one difference, because in the old shed there were these roof beams where you couldn't actually walk upright through the space. So we introduced this ridge beam, and then this one column you see here resting on a marking of the foundation of. So the original shed was actually built over two times, and this is a reference to the gable of the first shed.
So the next project is actually the first project that we finished. It's called Nørrehus, and it's a conversion of a common courtyard in a building block in Nørrebro in Copenhagen. And it's a project that we sort of created in the sense that the owners association, they had set aside some finances to repair the asphalt of the courtyard. So it has this large paved area, and we suggested to them that instead of transforming the asphalt, maybe they should discard it and create a green courtyard instead. And so we created an assignment for that had a very tight budget, and this is sort of was the defining design parameter for the project. So basically we started by identifying things like the sewage. So these are the red dots you see here as all the places, all the switch. And we made an analysis of how much pavement could we remove. So this was without moving any of the drains. And we had to leave some in the sides in order for a lift to be able to pass around the building to service the gutters. And so we built in the excess soil, which is by definition, without actually being it, but by definition defined as polluted when it's in Copenhagen. So it had to be sort of disposed of, which is costly. So we built it into the terrain and made these small hills. And then we collected the functions from the old shed in an addition to an existing open glass roof that was on this part of the site. And basically we sort of went through the site one-to-one and checked on the conditions of the ground and of the surfaces, and we drew the curvature of the cut in the pavement directly on site. So you see Sebastian here drawing the line. So it would actually be quite easy for the contractor to just do the cut and remove the pavement. And we left a smaller island in the middle of the courtyard. And we did new pathways in concrete tiles, standard concrete tiles. And then we cladded the existing glass roof shed, glass roof structure with the sides. And on the side facing the garden, we used mirror plates to sort of extend the green space, but also to create a barrier. We made an espalier that with the plants growing in front of the mirrors, there would be this kind of extra layer. Do you see here? And so basically this, what you see here, is the existing glass covering that we wrapped with gates on one side, mirrors on this side, and then we added a new structure on this side. And basically, you see the plan, this is the new structure here, and this is the wrapped structure. And also based on the idea of working with the low project, strict economy, we had this idea that the building should have sort of a garden-like characteristic, even though that it would house garbage containers and stuff like that. So instead of doing an espalier, we mounted the cladding on the inside of the structure to use the structure as to give this espalier-like character. And one space in the structure we had to be insulated, so we mounted another layer of plates on top of the structure, and then on top of that we mounted the next year especially. But this actually allowed us to work with the plywood plates, which is quite cheap, painted. You see the elevations, the view from one of the spaces, which is for the person who maintains the courtyard, and he has this like a workshop space. This is a pram space, and this is a space for exchanging leftover furniture and stuff like that between the inhabitants. Next project.
I think we are more or less on time. I hope so. So we have a few projects more to show. This is also one of the first projects to be finished. It was in 2015, 5 years ago. And it's a project placed it's called Skjern River Pump Stations. It's placed very close to the first project that we were showing tonight, that Søren was showing. So it's in another natural area in a national park along this river Skjern. In the 60s, the river was straightened out, as you can see on this photograph. And as part of this land reclamation project, they had to drain the water, and they made a series of pump stations. And after just a few. It was actually, I think it was the biggest project in Denmark of like really changing the land in this huge area. But already a few decades later, it was made back to more or less its original run because they found out that it was a very big environmental disaster to change these things. So a new natural area was reappeared and with a lot of visitors. So these pump stations still working as pump stations, but with pumps now in the basements. So these structures could actually be used for visitor facilities. And this was the requirement for the task that we were asked to do was to change these pump stations into also using be used for viewing points and exhibitions and different purposes. These this is how the pump stations were looking when we started the project. So not a lot was done to them over these approximately 50 years, and we were somehow quite fascinated by this concrete relief. You can obviously see that these machine buildings not made for people to use, but more like this function buildings. But this concrete relief was somehow standing out. So we took a starting point in this how we could work with this. And this is a quick survey that we made with, during the first visit, and we went home and starting to find out how to work with this, and we found out that we could do this so what you see here, it's the new extension of one of the pump stations. You just see it here, so it's an interpretation of the existing concrete relief, but made on one hand a contrasting material, a new material made in wood. This is where you see. So this is the original. We didn't change anything really here, but by adding this extension in wood, somehow the old concrete becomes somehow more light, and the wood has this kind of heaviness of the concrete. And this is kind of weird play between new and old, where you are on one hand, when you just see it, are not sure what is new and what is old, and when you get closer, you start to notice. So we wanted to have this. This is from another pump station. We want to have this unity between new and old, so the new situation within the extension was this one thing, but on the other hand, changing the existing. So this pump station, pump station east, it was already a little bit like narrow and tall, so we wanted to emphasize this quality, these proportions by adding a rather tall extension. And again, you have this feeling of this kind of play between the two materials and the new and old. Another aspect of the existing pump stations were these red brick gables and the gray concrete walls. And actually, by moving in the landscape, you would see the building change quite a lot. So this kind of feeling of yourself moving in the landscape by moving around the pump station was quite interesting, and we wanted to work with this, but in a smaller scale, more close-up scale. So some of the wooden profiles that we used in the extensions were painted in this very this blood orange color, very present color from specific angles, and from other angles you wouldn't really see it. Also in the interior, we worked with this to add a warmth to this, like a warmer quality to the new spaces, because now the pump stations were used for visitors, so it was suddenly a different purpose. People would stay there watching the landscape, maybe watching the birds or eating picnic on different purposes. So so we wanted to, by adding this wooden material, we wanted also to emphasize that it was a new purpose. Here you see some framed views from the new rooftop. And the last of the three pump stations was also the smallest one, and it was just one room, and it was already we didn't feel like it was not really necessary to build on the top because it was very close to the river. So instead we made a small extension on the site, introducing a new access from the site and making a small viewing platform, as you see here. So this is an example of how we worked differently with the new wooden structure. So we were quite interested in seeing how far could we take this wooden relief from this is what you see here is where you don't see the extension in direct relation to the concrete, so it becomes more something on its own, but it's still somehow referring, you still see somehow a bit of the relief. So we were quite interested in seeing how we could work differently with this kind of system that we introduced. Here you see how we also wrapped this high voltage box. The last and the biggest pump station, you see a plan here with the existing situation and new situation, introducing an access and a stair to the roof. So also interior-wise, we worked with these colors, but here, because it's not in the subtle landscape, but more in this kind of already red interior. So here we work with these screen walls to protect the visitors for using these panels, controlling the pumps, and thereby controlling the water on the nearby areas. And in this way, we could, like very simple, somehow slightly change the appearance of this existing space by working with this. Again, you see really how much is a pump station, all this all these underground chambers moving the water, and then this exhibition space and the viewing platform on top. We introduced these large windows where we already had openings in the structures, but now with the new purpose, it became suddenly something new. It was originally about bringing in and out people repairing the pump or the pump to be repaired, but now it's suddenly a completely different situation. Now you have this framed view to the landscape. Some details. And a few places we could not use the wood because of fire regulations, and we could not work with very heavy structure because it was with a basement underneath. So we introduced these light concrete blocks. They're very fragile, especially in the corners. So we introduced this simple concrete block in the corner to make this very kind of subtle relief, this kind of small ornament, you could say, and only painting the stones slightly, so you could still feel the quality of the stones, but slightly painted with this gray silver paint. This is the plan of the roof extension of pump station north. That's pump station where you can see that we have partly covered spaces and partly open spaces. And we made this new these new structures by using this relief, but also using it as the main structure. It's not like this main structure and substructure, or you could say cladding. It's everything is the same, so we could say that we somehow took out one layer of the structure by not having a main structure and a cladding, but actually having the relief as the structure, as you can see here and also on this photograph from the construction. So it was actually very simple to build also during the cold and wet winter season in Denmark. This is from cutting the hole to the stair. So just to finish, you are in the landscape on the ground, and by climbing the stair, you are in this more like dark and narrow space excluded from the landscape. And you enter the last run of the stair, and you have the light coming in, and you finally enter the roof platform with this framed, different framed views to the landscape.
So, cool. How are we on time? Can we do one or two projects more, or it's okay? Great. Okay. So the next project is somehow it's different from the other projects, and so it's a contribution to the exhibition Alternative Histories, which was organized by Drawing Matter and the Architecture Foundation in London. And we were asked to reimagine the sketch by Peter Merkle. It's called 1226 in a model. And so we looked at the sketch and tried to sort of understand what's going on. And what we took from it is that we have sort of this this solid figure, which is balanced on something, which we think are columns, and the solid figure has openings, and there's sort of a layered space behind the openings, so you can sort of see another space and another opening behind the opening. So, but one thing that sort of that we found sort of strange or hard to understand was these very thin columns. So in order to make them understandable to us, we reimagined them as being walls, so it would be the end of the walls. And so basically we created this concept for the model where there's inner load-bearing walls going up through the solid, which is outer cantilevering walls. So basically these are sections from below. And in the outer cantilevering walls, we made openings to create this spatial depth from the sketch. So we decided to do the structure from arid concrete blocks and to cut them down in, so basically to take like a standard building block and cut it down to 1/20th of its size. And actually, we made a calculation error when we were planning, so we thought we had to do just a few hundred, and that we later figured out we had to do 700 of these blocks. So we might have chosen a different material if we had done the calculation correctly. But here you see the cutting process. And so the thing is, this project was to us a project that would be concluded with the model, and as maybe you also get the sense from what you have seen so far, we have sort of a lot of interest in this idea of seeing the building take shape physically one to one, and knowing that this would not have that future, we wanted the model to be that endpoint, and in that way not be able to be converted into something. To be converted into something else. So in another word, that the representation becomes the final product. And we used also in this case the mortar that you use for joining the aerated concrete blocks to join the blocks. And we built up the structure top down, so because it has the heavy top, and because it's basically a structure that is stacked and hanging at the same time, and it's basically just held together by the mortar. We had to do it like this, and then turn it over when the mortar is dry. And so here's a few images of the structure turned upside down, or as it was built. And then turned around. And basically, so the top walls are cantilevering in the corners, and they are supported by the inner walls. And in order to keep as much structural integrity in the cantilevering walls as possible, we decided to do as few bondings between the inner and the outer walls as possible. We decided that one wall could protrude below the cantilevering wall and have one bonding that you see in the top here, and one wall would stop and not protrude below and have two bondings. So this has a bonding here and a bonding here. And this created the last element of the sketch. So basically what you see in this photo is that one wall stops behind and one protrudes. And so this is the actual sketch. Everything is one-to-one, directly derived from the sketch. So this is the sketch. And this is the missing column, which is the overlayering of the two walls that you see face on. And the only real difference between the sketch and the model is that we didn't do this window because we liked it better without. So, final project.
Well, so the very last project that will just show a few images from the construction site. Maybe I just want to say that in my introduction, I said that we would only show build projects tonight and then this final project under construction. And I would still insist that we did. But of course, what Søren was just showing, it's on one hand, it's a one-to-one building. This kind of thing of what happens in one-to-one in this scale, where you can somehow hang the stones that you could not scale up 20 times, and then it would still be a doable structure. These kind of things interest us a lot. We did work with the one-to-one scales, alternative histories model, in the kind of logic of. So the last project, it's a combined office and warehouse. It's in a town just outside Copenhagen, a bit south of Copenhagen. It's for a medical company. And we'll just show, I think, mainly show a few images from the construction of the project. This is the site. So it has this kind of green open space. And it has this access road with delivery and parking for the people working there. So it's organized around this big, huge space of storage. And then these offices, this is one part of the company, and this is another one, and they have this meeting point in the middle. This is a photograph, I think, just from, is it from June this year?
Yeah.
Just some month ago. And these images are taken a few months ago. It's a prefab concrete house with these sandwich concrete panels. And we have been working with this combination of your large part of the project is this, these closed elevations of the warehouse, and other parts are more open. So we have been working with this this kind of system that can somehow continue all over the building, but in different, could say in different enclosed version and open version. We also have, which you don't see on this picture because it was not placed at that time, but we also have these open cupboard terraces with these columns and beams. Maybe we can go on.
So basically, the two parts of the offices here and here, they are on two different elevations. So this is higher than here. And this is what you see in this image, that the elevation or the height of the offices change. And basically, to us, we knew in the beginning of this project that we had to do the house in concrete in order to have a large thermal mass in the building, to have a stable temperature for storing these medical equipment. So it was in a way, in the same way as for instance, the Tipper Tower and other projects that we did, we wanted to learn about the production facilities. And we have based the design of this project on a research on the production facilities of a certain factory in Jutland that you see a picture from here.
Maybe we should say that in Denmark, it's really like the very most common way of building these kind of houses. So when it comes to a little bit of larger scale offices and not at least warehouses, you would see these prefab concrete elements, but often you see them as a kind of very strict and very it's also a very cheap way of building. So we have been trying to really understand what is possible, what is not possible within this world of building, within this building technique, and really try to find all details, you could say, and really make the house out of being built in this system. Often you see these concrete houses being wrapped in all kind of materials, somehow blurring what they are actually built from. We wanted to do it a bit the other way around, so we did not adding any extra layers, but just working with what was possible within this way of building. So maybe to just to summarize the very first what I was mentioning in the very beginning of the lecture about this working with a building technique. It's something that really interests us a lot, and actually we have been working with quite a lot of different materials, but also different techniques within materials. So we've also been working with different ways of working with different ways of building with wood, for instance, and we don't know what would be the next, but it's very interesting to kind of meet a completely new unknown material and to really investigate what is possible, you could say, within this.
A few model studies, interior models.
So maybe just to conclude, we want to make a few, make a little bit of advertisement from a book that just came out from our office. So actually, it's a book showing the very first project that we had tonight to share with you, and the other project in the same part of Western Jutland in Denmark.
I don't know if they can see us. So I think that was it for our presentation.
Okay, thank you very much for your presentation. Děkujeme také našim divákům, že se díváme. We have now possibility to discuss with our public, and we can use a Slido application, which you can see under the presentation on Facebook. Můžeme se přes aplikaci Slido připojit s otázkami. Pokud máte dotaz v češtině, přeložíme ho do angličtiny, takže se klidně ptejte. Já začnu první. So you could hear a little bit of Czech now. So I will start the discussion. We will see if some questions will come. So my first question is, because you have a lot of beautiful pictures, like photographs of your projects, but also of landscape. Do you collaborate with some photographs, or do you do your own photographs at the beginning, or is it a mixture, or how important is it for you?
So we have two different photographers that we are collaborating with. So the last project that you saw from the construction side, it's and also from Tibone and Skjerno, that is a photographer called Rasmus Nolander, who is a Swedish photographer who lives in Switzerland. And we also do our own pictures going through the process, but our experience is that this is like this is something that is that a good photographer is really is the best way of getting the pictures right. We have the experience with the Nolander, which was the first time we had a photographer on a project on Skjerno, was that we had been spending a lot of time taking pictures of structures, and he came and he spent a day going around with his camera, and he uses an old-fashioned not a digital camera, but one that exposes on large format, and he would expose, I think, maybe 40 negatives, and we would have 30 something usable, very nice pictures from that. There's a precision to this that craft.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I wanted to also to ask, I felt a lot of haptical details in your project. Haptical, like that you feel the structure of materials or some connections that you can almost touch it also on images. How important is it for you, like, to feel these details?
Well, it's very important because we find a lot of potential and inspiration in the way of building. You could say that when you make a structure, if you make a house, you need something to make it. You need something to carry it. You need something to close the house if you need to close it. I mean, you have already a lot of things there. So often we work with low budgets, and it was very interesting to see how we could use these elements that are making up the houses. So really work with these different materials and columns, beams, and surfaces, and details, to really work with them and get something out of it, and to add a character to the space by working very specifically with materials, but also looking at, we had some projects also tonight that we shared with you, working with existing structures and extensions and rebuilding, like the pump station. So it was very interesting for us to find also a way of detailing, constructing, that is maybe, if you would see it loose from the context, it would it would be something very different. But seeing it together with the context, suddenly you understand why it's detailed like it is. So for instance, with the wooden extensions on the pump stations, they somehow work together with the existing. So it's a very simple, rather simple detail to build, but it has, we're searching this precision in detailing and choosing the final way of building.
Okay, thank you. I can't see any questions from audience, so can I ask another question?
Yeah, okay.
I would like to hear more about your beginnings, like how easy or difficult is it in Denmark to start office, if you can share your experiences with us.
It's a very nice question that you're answering, because actually we were very lucky in the sense that because when starting an office, you need one or some assignments to get on, and that's always a very difficult thing to have the first assignment, to get the next assignment, to show that, to prove for the next client that you can actually know how to build and know how to be good enough, to be a good architect. So so we were very lucky that we were at that time working in an office where this owner of the office, he offered to take part in this application to get our first assignment, which was the one on the Tiberne with the viewing tower. So he actually went into this assignment as a kind of guarantee for the client to secure that he's this kind of new established office. At that time, actually, it was not even officially an office. We actually just wanted to try it on our own to see how it would evolve. So he somehow very generous gave this kind of security to the client, and that was why they were actually in the end choosing us. And I can only hope that that other people would maybe do the same. Maybe one day we have a chance to give something back. But it's a very interesting way actually, because he did it from pure generosity, and it was not, he didn't get anything out of it from apart from helping us. And he actually told that when he was a young architect, someone helped him in the same way. Mm-hmm. It was a kind of very interesting way of getting started.
Nice. So we have the first question from audience. What is your approach to learning, growing within your own office or practice?
Yeah, that's also a nice question.
For growing?
Growing or learning?
Learning? Growing or learning?
Yeah. From your own practice.
Maybe I will do get it. if I understand it correct, it's I don't know if it's correctly understood, but so we started obviously just the two of us, and then I think it's about approximately seven years ago, and now we are seven people. It's not it's a bit of a coincidence, but it actually is more or less what happened, that we became every year maybe approximately one more in the office. And it's on one hand we are, it's already very happy to be more people, but it's also it's also a decision not to grow too fast. It's a kind of dilemma by all this kind of all these questions of how should we develop the office, and it's, for us it's very important that that we don't lose the grasp of the buildings we make. And we really want to, we are quite into very many details in every project. So we really try not to grow too fast, but we also like the benefit of being more people. So we can, for instance, with the last project that we were showing tonight, that we can also handle larger projects. So that was one part of the question. The other part was how to learn, right? Mm-hmm. I think it goes a bit together. So of course, by having the chance now to build larger scale, it's of course a very big chance, and especially to see how we can try to keep these things that we are very much into in building. So really to be into details and working with space and material and yeah. Mm-hmm. All these things that interest us a lot. not to kind of lose the grasp of the overall project.
So we have two more questions.
Sounds good.
Would you rather repeat projects made out of wood and steel or the prefabs concrete?
So I think it's not, I don't think it works in exactly that way for us. I think to us, we very much like to go into the process and to identify what is the right answer for the specific situation that or the specific challenges that we are facing within the project. And then we start to get some clues on what materials, how is this going to be manufactured? And then when we know that, then we can sort of move into that space and start learning about that, taking that knowledge and transforming it into a design. So I think we have to keep an open mind to stay true to our method. We cannot sort of decide on a material. That would not be the correct way.
Yeah, I can understand. So more questions are coming.
That's great.
So if you can choose, what type of the building would be a challenge for you? What would you like to design if you can, or if you would solve your... if you could choose which kind of project, like...
No, I think it's a nice question because if you have been looking at the different projects tonight, we have one project was, I could almost say, a garbage shed. It was like this with the green one in the courtyard. In one way, it is like really not a very it's not a very sexy project. But we somehow within this very like limited these limited possibilities and this kind of really like everyday program, I think we found a lot of interesting issues. And I think it was in the end very nice to see how we could change this courtyard for all these people living in this. This house around it, and now we are building this warehouse and this office, and it's actually some of these projects are, I could say, quite everyday project. Some of them are a little bit different, but it's actually quite interesting to find inspiration also within something like a warehouse, like a storage space, to see what we can find in this. Of course, it would be nice to build a museum or a church or something like very special. Obviously, it would be, but I think for us, it's not so much about this than it's about if we allowed to find something within. What is there? So I don't know, maybe you can add.
I think you said it very nice.
Okay, we have another interesting question. What is the best way to study landscape? You are working with for you, spending some time there, sketching, taking photos, or something else?
I think that's three nice suggestions. I think you sort of have to create an understanding of the landscape. So I think it's more than I think one thing is, of course, you have to know what is the purpose of the landscape. Is it does it have sort of an aesthetical purpose somewhere as an experience or? Is it also what is the history? So you have to collect also the information to know about. It's sort of in the same way as if you work with an existing structure, then you have to also get a lot of knowledge on this structure to actually to be able to go into a dialogue with it. I think it's somehow comparable.
But actually, to be honest, sometimes it's also just about being in the landscape and to somehow experience and to get it, to understand it. So, for instance, at the at the Tiberne Peninsula, where we built the tower. We actually really, in the beginning, we went there quite a lot of times and really had these long walks. Even you have this very low water areas where you can, with some high boots, you can somehow walk through the water. It's a very special landscape, and we had this like walks for hours sometimes, and also to understand where to place the different elements in the landscape, and to understand how important it was to make something with a very simple figure, and then within this kind of defined. So we quite soon realized that everything was so kind of visible, and making something like too noisy in the landscape would not be the right answer. So to really, on the other hand, something that should be different when you walk in the landscape, it should change. And it's kind of things that you start to understand by being in the landscape.
So another particular question is, what program or software do you work with?
So we have our very lean setup, which is AutoCAD, SketchUp, Adobe, Office.
It's very it's not very special. But maybe we didn't show anything from SketchUp tonight, but we often detail things very much. I mean, to a very high detail in the 3D model. We don't spend a lot of time on making renders or making. It's more like a tool, like you could say. It's a bit like keep it inside the office or for the client to kind of communicate. But it's for us. It's very. It can be really down to. We have an issue right now with part of the last project we were showing, where we have this steel building, small steel building. It's a kind of shed with these kind of functions that you need, and it has been detailed with 10 millimeter steel, and now the contractor asked if they can do it in 8 millimeter steel, and it's something that we could not just say yes, please build it in 8 millimeter. We have to see it in the 3D model, and it sounds maybe a little bit like what is, I mean, can you really see it? But our experience is that these kind of things actually mean a lot when it comes to when you see the close-up detail, but also when you see your.
So another question is, if you ever been in Czech Republic, I know you went twice, so we skip this. But another question of the same.
We're looking forward to come tonight also.
Yeah.
We already booked Villa Müller, but
Next time. After Corona. So the part of the question is, have you ever thought about moving from Denmark?
Well, both of us lived abroad in different periods. I was working in Belgium for 3 years and also lived in England before School of Architecture. And you lived in
Berlin. But is the question about the future or is if we have plans to move out of the country?
That was I don't know.
but it was also kind of... I think it has been very giving to be abroad, and I don't know if it will happen again. I think right now we are quite happy set in Denmark, and it's quite interesting to get inspiration from colleagues around the world and other European countries, and at the same time it's interesting to see how these references, you could say, how we can somehow how we can work with them locally, in the sense that that the building industry is always a bit different from country to country. So use, for instance, these concrete blocks that mm-hmm. we were using in the model. Alternative histories, it's a kind of rather common thing in Denmark, especially in these kind of rural buildings, industrial buildings. And so it has something like, maybe in Belgium it's a different, it's more like a brick with a yellow brick with these kind of called snilbau stone, this kind of halfly insulated brick. So there are these kind of different materials from country to country. Also this very long tradition since the 60s and 70s with this prefab concrete elements. It also exists a lot in other countries, but often you see more prefab concrete, in situ concrete in other European countries, where in Denmark it's really like this prefab industry. Mm-hmm. So there are slightly different things that we find very interesting to work with and not against. So we try to sometimes to develop a project within mm-hmm. this industry that we just see all around us, and then within this try to find something special.
We have another 5 questions. Do you feel to answer to all, or should we do one?
For us it's fine.
Okay. Yeah, no. What is your perception of your practice? Is it a personal fulfillment in architecture, or do you see the practice as something that will, with time, have a life of its own? Philosophical question.
It's both, definitely. I think that would be the question. I'm just guessing on your behalf, of course, but there's definitely an element of personal fulfillment, but there's definitely also the work on creating something that has sort of its own life within, and especially as we are also becoming more people. This is a very interesting work also. Yeah.
So about the first project, the question, was it important for you to narrate the path between each building as it was newly open for public, or use of some graphic manual?
Can you repeat it?
Was it important for you to narrate the path between each buildings as it was newly open for public, or use of some graphic manual? Maybe if the people can understand the path like sensitively, or do they need some manual to find the way, as I understand, but I'm not sure.
Okay, so in which project are we talking about?
The first one.
So how to find their way around in the landscape.
Yeah.
So I think this is also within, this is the area of the nature agency. So basically there's when it comes to wayfinding, there's an existing scheme for these kind of, that's actually implemented throughout all of the nature agency's land in Denmark. But obviously the elements are present in the landscape in a way, so you they actually also are telling you that creating a curiosity in wanting to move towards them, and it's an open landscape, so it's possible to find views from one structure to the next.
Yeah. By placing the height, for instance, a bit far out in the landscape, that was really to get people, as it was a bit like it's a kind of marking in the landscape to navigate.
It was also because when you're working with a protected landscape, the legislation wants that you sort of create, that you collect, build structures into a settlement to have the smallest possible impact on the, what they call the image of the landscape. But our analysis, our understanding of the site is that it would not benefit from having this character of a settlement on this place, because it's just this open plain. And we wanted each element to be sort of its own freestanding little thing on this surface. And we only had limited possibilities of where to place the objects. But by taking one object and placing it further away from the others, we could sort of create a tension between an object standing close to the house and one standing further away that would sort of give a sensation of things not being trying to lump together into one set of it. So keeping this spread out feeling of the elements.
So another last three questions.
It's fantastic with all these questions. We appreciate that.
Great. So how do you usually work? Do you use models? Do you sketch personally? Or what is your normal like day of work on the project?
I think there's a huge difference between what part of a process.
At the beginning, probably.
In the beginning, yeah. I think that we do a lot of course, sketching by hand, combined with studies, three-dimensional studies in the computer. And I think now we are spending a lot of effort on the construction side, and we do a lot of actually sketching in hand and
details,
having them transferred into AutoCAD.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Do you have any good book recommendation for Christmas? Maybe your book. Great. Are you working in Scandinavian only, or you are working in many countries all over the world?
If we do, or if you would like to.
We have any Czech project?
We've done competitions out of Denmark, and we have also done a small pavilion in Kassel in Germany for the Documenta, like a big art fair in Kassel. Mm-hmm. That is every fifth year. So we did a small exhibition space in the Bauer Garden in Kassel. So, but besides from that,
and we worked on a proposal for a pavilion next to the Sydney Opera House. Mm-hmm. And we actually went 2 years ago. We went to present it, but unfortunately, the finance was not found. But there's a little chance that for the 15th anniversary in a few years of the opera, I think
Sydney Opera House,
2023 mm-hmm. maybe. There's a chance that they will build it. So,
good neighbor.
It would be nice. Yeah, a temporary pavilion.
Yeah, nice. And the last question, which is quite interesting.
Okay.
Do you know some Czech or Slovak architect? Do you know any? Like, also from history, probably.
Klesnik, is he?
Yeah. He's Slovenian one, but he realized something in Czech Republic. Yeah.
That's a good question.
We definitely do, but...
No, never mind. Okay. So thank you very much for your time and for a very nice discussion during the evening. Please hold on Zoom. We stay in contact. And I will just finish the presentation in Czech, so thank you very much.
Thank you.
Děkujeme vám moc za pozornost a těšíme se na vás zase v březnu a děkujeme za přízeň, kterou nám nechá, vlastně s náma zůstáváte i v průběhu online verzí. Moc si toho vážíme. Naschánou.